Welcome, welcome, everyone. This is number 3 of 3 of the Wellth series with Valerie, and we're going to be exploring a few more topics on today's call, and I'm hoping that you've listened to number 1 and number 2 because they're fabulous videos, and I think there's some really wonderful nuggets in there, and I think it also is a way to highlight this wonderful person called Valerie, who's here with us, and getting to know her through these videos, I think you will also join with me in celebrating who she is and what's happening for her in her life as it unfolds.
Thank you. Yes.
So I think what we'll do is we'll get into consciousness, because that's what we shared that we would look at in video number 2. And to take a look at that word, and I explained how it's linking into the world of grandchildren and grandparents. And yet I know that Valerie is exploring this topic more and more all the time. And I'm just going to ask what does consciousness mean to you, Valerie? And then we'll maybe pick up on that and unpack it a little bit more. But how would you, if someone says, what's the definition of consciousness, what would you share?
I would share a couple of things about consciousness. So I dance in this area of consciousness and human potential. So it's the nature of beingness. It's who and what we are. And I spend a little bit of time in my courses focusing on the what part, because I hear too many times the statement that I used to believe in that I don't believe in anymore, I'm just human, or I'm only human. You know, I make mistakes, I'm only human. And so consciousness is a word used to embody this nature, the nature of human beings. And what I think of it as a combination of the aspect of me that is in this world, so the sentient nature of me, that's the 5 senses, the sentient nature of me that travels in this physical body and can touch and taste and smell and hear and reason. And so sensate, sentient. And then there's the spiritual, out of this world, larger than life, definitely not human, aspect of who we are. And that together, consciousness is the realm in which we play. So the consciousness, I mean, I even believe my book had a consciousness when I was writing it. And now that it's been published, the book has a consciousness of, you know, being an essential tool in this movement that I'm creating. So it's connected to essence, and consciousness is the expression thereof, of essential nature with human elements in that are required in the third dimension.
Yeah, I associate being fully human and this notion of being natural and being planetary and other ways of looking at it. And I know you use the word sprites, I use the fae. And so when I go play with the fae and the ley lines of the earth, the planet, all right, I'm having fun with them. And I think that goes back to what we talked about in the other one around playtime and that. And this notion of the consciousness being much more than what we sometimes just think is the mind, there's much more to it, all right? And I love the word it, because it reminds me is the it is something you bring into thingness out of the field, out of the consciousness, and we bring it in. But it also reminds me as I transition. And so whatever it is, I transition because of the it. And that's how consciousness unfolds for me, because it comes out of, as you say, the reasoning aspect of it. It comes out of my playtime with the fae, right? And all that, it just comes through.
I love how you do that. the words, and I love that inquisitive nature of you. I really believe that curiosity and the, like, how do these things fit? And last time we were talking about the threads, and we talked about alignment and harmony. And to me, those are essential elements that I believe consciousness is constantly rising if we give it an opportunity to. It has a natural desire to be uplifted, to be elevated. And I feel like when you and I talk and I get to hear the magnificence of how words dance with you and the Fae, it's really awesome. Yes. I find myself kind of like missing a question because I'm just so tapped into what you're saying. And I almost missed you saying, what did you say it stands for? I transition, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I almost missed that. I was like, wait, back up. I get it now. Yeah. Very cool. Thank you, Steve.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah.
Very cool.
And what it does is it allows me to use those senses and heighten my use of them, right? So that they become useful, helpful, and eventful.
Juicy and delicious.
Yes. And I'd be curious, how do you see? S-E-E. How do you see? I'm just going to leave it that. I know it's, how do you see? Or why do you see? When do you see? Just use the word see. What happens for you with that word?
So seeing is very powerful. So it's one of those sensate aspect of the human experience, if you're fortunate enough to be able to see. And I connect see to perspective, which means all of a sudden, how I see what I see, meaning my interpretation of what's just flat there for me to see, is coming from somewhere. The interpretation of what I'm seeing is built on some historical perspective that's been planted somewhere. And when we don't have a historical implant, and we see something we can't imagine or have no reference point for, the experience of actually seeing it can be, you know, monumental and revelationary and very different. So seeing, for me, when I'm working with my students, it's about knowing the perspective. So this gets back to self-mastery. Who am I being when I think I'm being me? When I look at that and call it good, bad, or ugly, or I see it this way versus that way, they see it that way, I see it this way, that's based on a perspective. It may not have anything to do with that thing. Like, that thing is the same thing, no matter who's looking at it. But all of a sudden, we all are walking away with, perfect example is go to a movie with a friend and come out and have an argument about a scene. And it's like, well, that's not what he said. That's not what they were doing. Well, I thought so who's right? Well, everybody is. Who's wrong? Everybody is. If you didn't write it, you don't necessarily know. If you're not directing it, what you experienced may not have been what the director was trying to have you experience, not what that script was about at all, but you're seeing it through your lens and you're calling your lens the right one. The other thing I think of when I think of see, especially in the Western world, maybe, we are in a seeing is believing experience in this human. When I see it, I'll believe it. And if I can't see it, and by seeing, I mean, if I can see the data that proves it's all right, and there's been a double blind placebo controlled study, and on this side, if I can actually see the two dots connect, then I believe that the dots are able to connect. I believe that there's something there. And I think that that is very powerful, and we need that kind of brain, intellectual, analytical, left brain orientation to a lot of things. And the world doesn't operate that way. There are laws of the universe that are beyond physical laws. So this is what I was saying in our last segment when I was talking about living in harmony with universal laws. So universal laws are not necessarily seeing as believing laws. Gravity, you can't see it, but it's working. And that's just a physical law. So when you talk about spiritual laws, law of reflection, law of attraction, law of karma, law of harmony, law of reciprocity, law of resistance, law of gratitude, like when you start looking at spiritual laws, even though they can, many of them have been scientifically proven, most people don't relate to them. They don't know about them. They can't see them in operation. And so getting beyond the seeing as believing world is the only way you have the experience of the most magnificent aspect of you, that consciousness, essential nature that you are, because that essential nature is not of this world. It's not a seeing as believing aspect of you. And so for me, the seeing has to be tempered, or it has to, let's put it this way, it's not tempering it, it's expanding it. So it's expanding the seeing beyond the physical eyes and what they can see, and going to this space in the center of our chests, to your intuitive self, your third eye. So you got three eyes up here. So your third eye up here in the sixth chakra, third eye seeing, and seeing with the heart, the essential nature, the intuitive seat of the soul, as I call it and teach it, to see with a different aspect. And we're not taught to see that way. Some of us are, but most of us aren't taught to see life through the lens of love, to see life through the lens of possibility, to see life through the lens of tolerance and harmony, and to ask questions like, I want more harmony, so I will do this. We're taught, you know, we said this in a previous segment, we're taught fighting and striving and proving. And so for me, seeing is this, you know, what can I see when I close my eyes? What can I see when I stop talking? What can I see when I just believe that I'm here to be love? What can I see when I be that first? And then that shows itself to me. And then I can see it very clearly.
Yeah, it wasn't too long ago, I said to myself, I believe it, so I'm going to see it. And I said, I believe that they're unicorns. And I went for a walk with the two dogs that I was house-sitting, dog-sitting with. And we were walking along, and there's these two trees, and it was starting to get a little bit more towards dusk, so it was an evening walk. And the trees had leaned in slightly. Okay, this is what it appeared. And I have the photographs of it, right? And I had never noticed that they had leaned in, but it's not that they had shifted. This is how they were. And I went out, and when I went through what I call that portal, what did I see? A unicorn. All right. And I went, okay, all right, what's going on here? So I just continued my walk, and this notion of, if I see it, I'll believe it. If I believe it, I'll see it. And letting those interact with me. When you were sharing, that image came back, and I went, oh yeah, I've got those photographs, don't I? Yeah. And the two dogs leading me out. And it's just a fabulous way of remembering what you are sharing here. And I'm hoping others will have found their own examples of that in their life.
Yes, I think it's really important that part of the journey that I take people on is to first understand universal laws. So when I say your job is to live in harmony with the universe, and people are like, well, what does that mean? Is that like about environmental stuff? And I'm like, yes, and it's much bigger than that. And so part of it is, you know, we get the reticular activating system going by, I give them a sheet of paper that shows them the different universal laws and what they mean and how they operate. And then I send them out for a couple of weeks to go find where these laws are operating in their life. Like, as soon as I bring my mental faculty and awareness to it, the reticular activating system goes off. And now, because I'm more aware, I can start to tune in more and see it everywhere. And so they usually come back to me and go, I didn't know that's what it was. Wow. And so now it's a little bit of seeing is believing. So I'm activating that seeing is believing to get them into the space of believing is seeing. And to actually be able to trace back in their lives when a law was presenting itself and they didn't know they were bound by law, that they're, because I always say the law doesn't care whether you believe it or not, understand it or not, know it or not. The law doesn't care. The law is going to do what the law does. And you can't defy it. So you're bound by it. So why not work in harmony? It makes life easier. Like, makes life, you know, more grace-filled. It takes away all the struggle and striving. Just anchor into what the laws are setting, the framework that the laws are giving you to live the exquisite life that you desire. And that's the truth.
And there it is. Yes. Well, we're getting towards the end of this third video. And one of the things that I do is they offer the wealther that I'm having a conversation with. And I'm going to ask you the same. What is it in about 2 to 3 minutes that you would like to share with anyone who's listening into this video? And let's encourage them to watch number one and number two and listening to this third one. But even if they're only listening to this video, which is what is meant to be as well, what would Valerie like to share at this point?
It's coming in as like lots of one-liners. So the first one is, the universe loves you. And that you are in a magnificent field of co-creation. And at any given moment, when you sink into the love that is already a part of you and allow the love energy to connect with the love energy that's a part of everything in the universe, you can manifest at the speed of thought. I think the second thing is, to go easy on yourself, to go easy on yourself through your life, to allow your life to unfold in a divine right timing. So I have been on a journey to release impatience. And in impatience, I'm not allowing for the gestationary period that sets me in the perfect place at the perfect time to unfold that way. And so I struggle and I try to push, make it happen. Instead of kind of going, you know what? I think I'm going to go for a walk. I think I'm going to take a nap. I think I'm going to do something else that allows me to kind of just drop into a space of faith and trust and going easy. Go easy. I call it ease, peace, and grace. How can I have more ease, peace, and grace? And the way we can have it is to choose it. Choose it. Choose happy. Choose tolerance. Choose love. Choose peace. Choose like your essential nature, the magnificent essence that you always already are.
Thank you. Wonderful, wonderful. So on behalf of those who are listening in, thank you, Valerie. We so do appreciate getting to know you. And I'm going to invite you back another time because I think there would be some other topics that I believe would be, I'll say, worth exploring.
Yay.
Okay.
I love exploring.
And see where it might take us. Okay. And I know one of them I would so enjoy learning a little bit more about nature, trees, and how you interact with nature and trees. And do you have a favorite tree? Or do you have a favorite forest? Maybe just asking some of those kind of questions, because I think it would, and then we can take a look at this other world.
Yes.
All right. And see what unfolds for us at that time. How's that?
That sounds great. Yes, I would love to do that.
Okay. Well, then we'll set ourselves up for that, to have that happen. And so with that, again, on behalf of everyone, thank you, Valerie, for and for sharing. And with that, we'll close off and take care, everyone.